Today we're going to be focusing on houses and in particular checking roof compliance. And by compliance, what we're talking about is complying with the National Construction Code and any deemed to satisfy requirements, any engineer's details that might be up as an alternative solution, and manufacturer's details that also comply with referenced Australian standards. So that's what we're planning on covering today. We're going to be looking at all of these things, but in particular, what we're hoping that we can achieve is that we use your experience of the building industry together with some new perspectives to develop an intuitive understanding of the way houses actually work to resist wind loads. And so the bits of the houses that are actually resisting the loads, and you will develop the skills to be able to look at those and say, does that look sensible? Does that look as though it's going to be able to cope with the loads that we're looking at? And in particular, do you have a compliance path for that detail? Does it come out of 1684? Does it come out of an engineer's recommendations? Or does it come out of a manufacturer's guideline? So you know where they come from, and you know that the things that you're using are compliant details for roofs. I'm starting with this photo. This is a car. We all drive cars. We probably came here in a car. And we expect that the cars have been designed to offer protection in the event of a design accident. So this accident is less than the design accident. People have walked away from it okay. There is absolutely no problem with the people. They have been well protected by that. In effect, that is a test of the compliance of that particular vehicle to the design rules and the way the people have assembled the vehicle so that it protects the occupants. Have a look at this one. This is also built to in a compliance kind of way, and we're expecting that the people who are building it are putting together details in such a way as the occupants are going to be protected in a design event. This event was a lot less than the design event. Unfortunately, the occupants weren't in the garage. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been such a happy outcome for them. So it is really important. What we in the building industry are doing is building a protection cage for people in the event, unfortunate event, of a high wind event. They'll be able to survive in their protection device, which is their house. Okay, so that wind loads. Wind puts loads on houses, and we're going to explore that to start off with. It puts on pressure on the external surfaces that create tons of uplift on the roof. And I'm talking 7 to 10 tons pulling the roof upward into the air. And we'll have a look at why with this particular model. So here we have a model of a house. As the wind hits the front of the house, it's pushing on this wall. We call this wall the windward wall, and it's tending to be pushed into the building. If you were silly enough to stand in front of the windows, you would see the windows are bowing inwards as the wind pressure is pushing on the outside of those windows. But the wind obviously can't come through the house, so it's got to go around the house. The wind hits the front, pushes on the windows, and then it gets deflected up over the top. As the wind is leaving the top of the building, it is actually moving away from the roof surface. So if we look at what that does to the roof, as it's moving away from the roof, it sucks air off the roof and it creates a suction on top of the roof. So we get suctions on top of the roof that are tending to lift the roof up into the air. And you can see that it's moving away from the edge of the roof demonstrably at the very edge. So at the very edge, it's pulling away from the roof and we get really high uplift on the edge of the roof. As it curls and goes over the top, we get another region of really high uplift just behind the ridge. Now, if we think about the sidewalls, exactly the same thing that happened on the roof is happening on the sidewalls. The wind hits the front of the house, it goes out around the side, and can you see the direction the wind is going there? It's going away from the sidewalls, so it's pulling air out of the sidewalls, and we're getting suction on the sidewalls as well. We get pressure on this wall, suction on the roof, suction on the sidewalls, and on the back wall we get suction as well. So most of the house has got suction on it. The most important one for us today is the suction on the roof, because that's tending to lift the roof up and pull it into the air. And the biggest suctions are along the leading edge or right behind any ridge. or a hip if it's a hip roof, so that we get very high suctions in those areas. Another complication is if we've got an opening in the external envelope. So if there is an opening, air is going to be able to come into that opening, and we get the external pressure that was on that surface is now on the inside of the house. So if we've got an opening in a windward wall, it pushes air into the house, and now we've got pressure inside the house, the same pressure that was on that windward wall. Now in a tropical cyclone, if we have an opening develop in the front half of the cyclone, and then in the second half of the cyclone the wind is coming from a different direction, we may have that opening now on a leeward wall. And that's going to mean that the inside of the building is under suction, right? Or if the wind changes around so that the opening is now on the side wall, then we're going to have suction inside the house as well. And in this case here, we've lost a little bit of soffit under the eaves, and the wind has got up into the roof space and it's pushing up on the underside of the roof. What's it doing to the ceiling? It's pushing the ceiling down. And there are some cases where we have seen the ceiling being pushed down by that kind of air pressure. As far as the roof is concerned, and we're thinking about tying roofs down, this is the worst case where we have an opening develop on the windward wall, we get pressure inside the building. What's the manhole going to do? Blow up into the roof space, and now we've got the pressure on the underside of the roofing. So that this can double the pressure that's on the roofing. They're both pointing in the same direction. The suction's pulling it up and the pressure is pushing it up, and we get double the forces in all of our tie downs. So that we find that if we do have openings develop on the windward wall, then we could have very significant increases in the tie down forces that we require for the roof. Now, how could these openings develop? There are lots of different ways that these openings could be developed. In some cases, we've looked at damage where houses have been left with some of the windows open for the day because it was going to be a warmish day, then a storm has come across and there's been an opening already. In other cases, there's been debris. Now, this is a piece of debris has hit that window, and you can see it's broken and it's created a large opening that has let air into the building. What wall will that happen on? Always the windward wall. So debris is going to be part of the airstream. It's always going to hit the windward wall. That's going to let pressure into the building. This one here was a door that blew in. So a double front door, the wind pressure on the double front door broke the catch in the way you can see, and the door blew in. And again, there's a lot of pressure now inside the house. So openings can happen in many, many different ways. We've seen debris in cyclones. We've seen debris in non-cyclonic events. We've seen doors blow in cyclonic events and in non-cyclonic events. Damage happens to building in all regions of the country. These are some photos from Perth, and you can see that it's not particularly selective as to whether it's steel roof or tile roof. Damage does happen with the uplift. And again, this event was less than the design wind event. So these failures shouldn't have happened if everything was hunky-dory. Now, they're older buildings, but the same thing has happened to brand new buildings. Both of these were less than 2 years old. The wind event was less than the design wind event. This was a sheet roof and this was a tile roof. And so we can see that damage does happen because there are problems with tie down. If we think about it, which one do you think is going to fare better in the wind? Tiles or roof sheeting? Let's look at tiles. So here's some tiles, again after an event that was less than the design wind event. You'll notice that the damage is greatest up at the ridge, and that's where we have our high local pressures. We get those extra uplifts just behind the ridge, and that's what we're looking at here. But you'll see that the tiles are damaged everywhere. At less than the N1 design wind speed, there's enough uplift on a single tile to lift it. So that does tend to happen at less than the design wind speed. This has got a reasonably exposed position. This is an N2 position. And so we've had a lot more than the N1 design wind speed, even though the net wind speed on this building was less than the wind speed the house should have been designed for. Now, a lot of the tiles have blown off, but some of them have fallen in, so that this is a brand new house, a brand new tiled house that's had some tile damage, and tiles have been dropping through the lounge room ceiling. So that again, we're not looking at just property damage, but potential risk to occupants if tiles are going to be falling through the ceiling in those types of event. And sheet roofs aren't immune either, and we'll be spending a little bit of time unpicking what goes wrong with sheet roofs that are going to give rise to these types of problems. But again, this was a brand new building that had not had appropriate details in the tie-down chain. We'll start off by looking at wind classification. And wind classification is something that AS 4055 deals with. And there are a number of different classifications that all relate to the design wind speed for the particular house at the particular site that you're going to be working on. So a wind classification is not something that's for the whole of Perth, it's for a particular site. And why is it important? Because everything we do structurally in a house relates to the wind forces that are going to be on the house. So we have to understand for this particular site, what are the wind forces that are going to be experienced by the house? And it's going to affect member sizes, connections, it's going to affect bracing. It even affects the design of the windows and doors that you're going to order for your particular place. An alternative way of doing it, and this is something that's often done in the cyclone areas, is not to use 4055, which gives you an N or a C classification, but to use AS 1170 Part 2. If you do use AS 1170 Part 2, or the designer does use AS 1170 Part 2, they don't wind up with an NNC classification, they wind up with design pressures. And then every single structural detail in the house has to be designed to resist those design pressures, and that means everything has to be specified. So that's 1170 and 4055. Let's focus on 4055. This is the way 4055 looks at the design wind speed for a particular site. There's the site in this example. And the first thing is to look 500 metres from that site. And this red circle is 500 metres from that site. And we're looking for open spaces within that circle. And you can see there's an oval there. It's not a particularly big one. But if there is a big open space that encroaches on that circle, then that means that the wind speed is going to be a bit higher. The wind is actually slowed down as it moves over houses. So as it moves over houses, that causes the wind to tumble and it does slow down a bit. The fact that there's a big golf course here means there's a long run of wind over this open territory that isn't going to slow the wind down by the time it gets to that house. It takes more than 500 metres for houses to slow the wind down a bit so that this is a terrain category 2 site because of that large open area that sneaks into that red circle. Okay, the other aspect is shielding. And for shielding, we're looking not at, you know, what's 500 metres away, we're looking at what is immediately beside the site that we're dealing with. So that the shielding circle is here, this little yellow rectangle, and we're looking at, do we have 2 rows of houses all of the way around our particular site? If we do, then it's fully shielded. And it does require 2 rows of houses all the way around to give full shielding. The last thing we're looking at is topography. Is it on a hill? If it is on a hill, what's the slope of the hill? And where is this site in comparison with the bottom and the top of the hill? Wind speeds up when it goes over hills. So as the wind is approaching a hill, it gets squeezed to go over the top of it, and it can almost double in speed if the hill is steep and big enough. So hills are important, and we measure that with topography. Once we know what wind region we're in, and wind region A is for the southern part of WA, wind region D is for the worst tropical cyclone part of WA, wind region B is around Geraldton, wind region C is Broome and Derby. So we're up in that part of the state for wind region C. If you look at these, you'll see that in the southern part of the state, most houses would fall into the N2 category. You've got to be buried deep inside suburbia for it to be an N1 building. So if it's buried deep inside suburbia, N1 is the case. For a lot of smaller buildings or smaller towns, we don't get any terrain category 3, and a lot of buildings in smaller centres are going to be N2. For wind region B, you're effectively one wind classification higher, and you'll notice there's no N1 for wind region B at all, anywhere. And likewise, wind region C, you get C1s if you're deep in the middle of suburbia. Wind region D, there are no C1s. So that's the way the wind classification works. As a person in the building industry, you can do a really quick, rough check on the wind classification. High wind classifications are associated with exposure, either on the top of a hill or big open areas in front. Either way, you're going to get a great view. So what we tend to find is if you've got a great view, you need to have a higher wind classification. If you rock up to a building site and you see, yeah, look, this building's got no particular view. If you're in Perth, it'll be an N1. If you're in Geraldton, it'll be an N2, right? But then as you get further up and get a great view, you're going to be looking at the higher wind classifications. So if you're looking at a view like that, and you're looking at a plan that says N1, you immediately need to question that. What's the basis for this wind classification? And it is important. If you build an N1 house on an N2 site, your tie downs are all going to be half of the capacity that they need to be for the winds that are actually going to occur on that site. It's important to get it right. Then when we think about building, so working our way through the building now, there are a number of standards that we're going to use, including AS 1684, and we'll talk quite a bit about AS 1684 because a lot of the, and it's to do with timber frame construction, and it's to the reason we're going to focus on it is a lot of the roofs are timber frame throughout, particularly the south of the state. And then there's truss installation and masonry as well. In the building industry, if we're using timber for structural purposes, we should be aware of this standard and know what it covers and how it can help us. And here's the kind of things that it does cover. First up, limitations. Not all houses are going to be appropriate for AS 1684. There's a limit on the size of the house, so that we're talking about less than 16 metres for this dimension across a ridgeline. Walls heights per story of no more than 3 metres and roof slopes of no more than 35 degrees. So that there are a number of things that mean that if they're outside of those limitations, you can't really use 1684 and you're going to be relying on engineers' details for all of the tie downs in order to make sure that they're going to work. But 1684 gives us a lot of information, design information, construction practices, all of the span tables are in supplements, and the back part of it has a lot to do with tie downs, which is what we're going to focus on for really the rest of this session. So tie downs. The wind uplift happens to the roof sheeting or the roofing material, so that the roofing material is the part of the building that attracts the load. And it's got to be tied down to something, and it's tied down to the battens. And if the battens aren't tied down, they will disappear with the roof sheeting, so we tie the battens down to rafters or trusses. And then we tie down through the roof structure to this point, and then tie that point down to the walls, and have to have the tie down going all of the way down to the bottom. It's a chain. And if one link is inadequate, what's going to happen? The chain is no good. And we're going to lose part of the building, everything above that point. Now, with this tie-down chain, we're mobilising weight against this uplift. The uplift is pulling up so that if we're thinking about what we've got to do down at this level, we've got some uplift happening, but we've also got the weight of the structure above that level. So we're balancing weight of the structure against the uplift forces on the roof as we go down this tie down chain. And depending what the materials are, we might get down to no tie down required at all at this level. But there are some things that could happen with the building that mean we do have to tie down at that level as well. So here you can see how tenaciously the roofing is hanging on to the batten. right? So a lot of wind has happened, a lot of damage has happened, but the roofing has hung onto the batten. And here's another success story. See the way the roofing has hung onto the batten? Done a great job. But we've got a problem in our tie down chain here. These two nails were not able to do the job. Now that was old. No one does that anymore, do they? Wrong. Here's a brand new job with the same detail tying down the batten. So that we've got to learn that that doesn't work, this isn't going to work either. And we'll look a little bit more into that later on. This is underlining what that principle is. This is a roof that has disappeared, so you can see everything that is happening structurally in here. And you see these three big screws are taking the wind uplift into this batten. What have we got taking the wind uplift out of that batten? Would it look right to have two nails carrying the load from three big screws out of the batten at that point? No, it wouldn't. But yet that's what they built over in this part of the roof. So this part of the roof, the battens were nailed down. And this part of the roof disappeared early. And as it was peeling back, it pulled the roof sheeting off these ones where it was done properly. You can see they'd done it properly in part of the roof, but there was a part of the roof that hadn't been done properly. Even if it's one connection that's not done properly, that could be enough to get the whole failure chain working against you. So it's important to make sure that the connections are done correctly everywhere. As we chase these uplift forces down through the building, here you can see that these rafters are loading or transferring the uplift forces down into the wall system here. This one here is right over the top of a window. So its load goes into the lintel and is then transferred either side of that opening, and it then has to find its way down to the bottom. So these studs here are carrying much more uplift load than other studs in the building. And they may have to be tied all of the way down to the ground. So that you can see that inside a normal building, there are things that transfer load sideways and can concentrate the loads, and our tie down has to deal with that. Here we have it on a masonry building. You can see there's a lintel here with tie down into that lintel. What is tying down the ends of that lintel? Can you see anything tying down the end of that lintel? So all we've got tying down the lintel is the weight of these three courses of bricks, whereas we should be mobilising more force further down into the building. So it's important over openings that we tie down the outside as well. Let's return to my favourite, the batten to rafter connection. Remember when we were talking about the wind loads, we said we have much higher wind forces on the edge of the roof and behind any change of slope. That's a ridge or a hip and all the way around the edge of the building. If the wind is coming from this direction here, we're going to get high uplift on that edge. If it comes from this direction, we'll get high uplift on that edge. The wind could come from any direction, so we have to have these high uplift areas all of the way around the edges, all of the way around hips, and all of the way around the ridges, so that those shaded areas are the edge area of the roof that have these higher uplift forces and have to have better tie downs between the sheeting and the batten. Can you see that there's not a lot of general area left? So that if you're thinking, what's my ratio of number of edge connections to general connections, it's going to be about 3 or 4 to 1. So we may as well forget about the generals and just put edge connections everywhere. That way everything's going to be right. Okay, so that's 1200 millimetres or two battens up the slope and two battens down the slope from the ridge have to be part of the edge area. If we look at 1684, it tells us for a 900 millimetre rafter spacing and 900 millimetre batten spacing, this is what we need. For N1 in the edge area, screws, N2 screws, N3 screws, N4 screws. So that for all of the edge areas, you're going to be using screws. The only place we could use nails, and they'd have to be deformed shank nails, is in the general area. We would recommend that you use screws everywhere, and that way you don't have to worry, is this connection an edge or a general? You just use screws everywhere. Okay, and if you don't, Again, these are some pictures where the battens have come away, and as a result of that, there's been risk because these things have been flying around in the air, but as well as that, there's the potential for injury within the house as well. If we think about metal battens, for a while people were nailing metal battens, and we've shown that that doesn't work. None of the manufacturers recommend nailing, they recommend screwing the battens. And that's a screw on each side. This connection here is not going to work because the nail is the weakness in it. At half the failure load, when the batten load reaches the nail capacity, that nail will pull out, the batten will roll over, and it will tear through that screw. So it'll actually lever its way through that screw. So that doesn't give you the combined capacity of the screw and the nail. It effectively is only the capacity of nails. So that one is not going to work. What's the problem here? People have put tie-down straps over the metal battens. If the metal battens have to do a job, they're going to crush. If the tie-down straps are put in tension, they're just going to crush the metal battens. So the metal battens aren't going to be able to cope with those loads. In the cyclone areas, the wind uplift forces are much higher, and so we see we have to go to much more significant tie downs for batten to rafter or truss connections in the cyclone area. And this is a shot from a cyclone area. It was a brand new roof. So a brand new roof, but it didn't have adequate batten to rafter connections, and that was the failure. Trusses. For trusses, trusses are designed to a standard 1720.5. They're manufactured to this standard. But for builders, they have to install them to that standard. And the truss manufacturers also give some great information on how to temporarily brace them, how the final bracing has to look, and what tie-downs are required for trusses. Now with trusses, trusses concentrate the loads. So we get all of the uplift load on a panel of roof is carried down to the edge of the truss, and it has to be anchored at that point. So that as we go through the structure, we're getting more and more concentration of load, so that now we're looking at a large tributary area. All of that load has to be passed through this connection point here. And most truss manufacturers put an arrow where the support points are, so that it's really easy to work out whether they're in the right place or not. Over the next few slides, we will look at all of these issues. And we'll start by looking at what a ribbon plate is. So this is a truss, and the truss sits on an outside wall, but we require trusses to clear all of the inside walls. Because the truss relies only on support at the nodes, which is where these joints are, if we accidentally apply a load here in the middle, it hasn't been designed for that. So if it accidentally sits on an internal wall somewhere here, it could break the truss. So it's a requirement that the truss clears all of the inside walls, and the way it's normally accomplished is just to put a ribbon plate around the top of the external studs. It's nailed to the top of the external stud, but now when we tie the truss down, what do we tie to? If we tie it to the ribbon plate, it's just a packer sitting on top of the top plate of the external wall frame. It's going to fly away with the truss. We've got to tie it down to the structural element, which is this one here, so that we have to tie down to the top plate. Here's a case of where it's been done wrongly. This is the ribbon plate, and there's one nail through the ribbon plate into the top plate every 900 or 1200 millimetres along there. That's not going to transmit the load out of the ribbon plate into the top plate. Here's one where it's been done properly, and the strap goes all of the way down and under the top plate. That's going to tie the truss down. So this one, no good. That one is fine. Now, not all trusses are equal. Girder trusses. Girder trusses are trusses that attract load from other trusses in the building, either standard trusses or jack trusses, so that their tributary area is much higher, and as a result of that, their tie-down requirements are much higher. There was a girder truss over this building about here, and it was tied down with the same details as all of the standard trusses, but it picked up the load that of a number of other standard trusses so that its tributary area was about four times the tributary area of the standard trusses, which meant its tie downs were overstressed by a factor of four. It disappeared, it took all of the standard trusses that were sitting on top of it with it, and as a result, that's what the building looked like. This truss here, these are metal trusses, and they were inadequately tied down to the top plate, and they were starting to fail. Miraculously, they didn't. Why? The battens failed early enough to unload the trusses and they didn't completely let go, but they were on their way. There wasn't enough reinforcement under these areas where you have very high concentrated loads on thin pieces of steel. So those thin pieces of steel were starting to tear. There wasn't enough reinforcement in that location. Okay, so tying down of trusses, it's got to be pretty simple, eh? There's an arrow, you put the arrow on top of the wall, wrong, okay? So that the arrow should be over a wall. That's not the right place for the arrow to be. This is the right place for the arrow to be, but can you spot a problem here? They've tied it down to the ribbon plate, not to the top plate underneath it. So tying down of trusses, really important to get it right. Supports are generally indicated. This one's in the right place, but they were still building this house and hadn't put the tie downs in, so I didn't give them a cross for that yet. Tie downs and anchorage of trusses. Here is a cunningly designed plate that's enabling the truss to move up and down a little bit, but it transfers shear load to a bracing wall underneath. Isn't it a clever plate? So it allows the truss to move up and down and transfers the shear load. Do you notice anything missing? The screws that are meant to go through here that actually transfer the shear, okay? And this is in a real house just before they started cladding it. This connection here, does that look okay? It's certainly got lots of nails, but we'll explore what the problems with that type of connection are a little bit later on. Now we come to girder trusses. And as I said, this is a girder truss here, and this is a girder truss there. In order to transfer that concentrated load out of the standard trusses into the girder truss, you need this kind of connection. Right? That's the right kind of connection. This one here has got three or four nails, and it's light gauge steel, and it's not going to do the job. So that it is important that we get the right connection for our girder trusses. Okay, also tying down of trusses or rafters, if we use these kind of plates, this one here is bent. As that plate is put into tension, or that strap is put into tension, it's going to want to straighten, and it will simply pull this nail out. The act of straightening that will rip that nail out and will start losing capacity from that connection. This one here is done brilliantly. There's the ribbon plate. It's anchored well below the ribbon plate. Lots of nails in the right place, and the strap is kept nice and straight. Tying down of stick-built roofs. So that in tying down of stick-built roofs, we're going to use similar principles to the ones we've just been looking at. The first thing is, we haven't got a truss, which is a triangulated structure. We're going to try and build the triangulation into the roof. How do we do it? Collar ties. So we're looking at collar ties. Everywhere we've got an underpurlin, there should be a collar tie, which is going to give us the triangulation we need in the roof to spread the load right out to these edges. We also are going to make sure all of the tie downs are done well. If we tie the batten to the rafter, then that's going to look after transferring load out of the battens. But we also have to tie down all of the struts. We're pulling up on the top of the roof, and we've got lots of weight in the roof, in the ceiling, and in all of the beams that are part of the roof structure. We want to mobilize that weight to work against the uplift on the outer surface of the roof. So we're going to make sure that all of these struts serve to transfer all of that weight back up to the top here where it can work against the uplift. So that our principle is tying everything together here to mobilize the weight and ensuring that we've got good triangulation with the collar ties. So a coupled roof can rely on triangulation. It can rely on triangulation because the ceiling's down here. We've got this big space. We can build the triangulation into it with the collar ties. And there are the colletized now starting to make this look like a whole bunch of triangles that are going to be able to spread the load out to the edge. That's what happens if we don't have colletize, right? Instead of having this big triangulated structure, you've got a whole bunch of panels working independently. That's what happens in an older roof, and that's what happens in a newer roof if there are no colletize. So colletize have got a really important job to do. There are lots of common problems that we find with colletize. Here you'll notice they're absent, right? So no colletize there. We've got some colletize here. They're on every second rafter, which is quite okay if the rafters are at 600 millimetres so that your colletize are at the regulation 1200 millimetres, but these were at 900 millimetres. So at 900 millimetre rafter spacing, you need a colletize every rafter. And the colletize should be just above the underpurlin, not halfway between the two layers of underpurlins. Okay? So they're common things that we see. Now, this slide is here just to show you that when the wind is howling, everything in your building is working. So this is the batten sitting on top of the rafter. The colletize done a good job, and you'll see that has almost let go. The rafter sitting on top of the underpurlin, and that has stressed that connection. The underpurlin here to the stud, and you can see it has stressed that connection. And then the stud down to a strutting beam, and you can see it stressed that connection. All of these connections are going to be loaded in a wind event, and it's important that we do a good job of making sure all of these connections are sound so that we're going to have the right number of nails through a tab, we're going to have nail plates at the bottom of the strut, our colletize are going to be done properly, and we're going to use appropriate connections between the rafter and the underpurlin. So if we can do all of that, everything's going to work. Now sometimes the carpenter knows what he's got to do, but bad luck happens when he's doing it. For example, here's a strut that split when he was nailing it in. So what's going to happen to that one? Have we got the right number of nails? No, we haven't. And it's not going to be able to transfer the load. Here, when that bird's mouth was being cut, there's a lot of overcutting. Is that going to cripple that connection? You betcha. What does the carpenter do if he finds, yeah, look, some bad luck has happened and now I'm messed up? It's simple. You just put a strap over the top, nail it down here, nail it on the other side, and you've got a good connection. So even if bad stuff does happen, both of these could be fixed up by a strap. Now this one here, we've got a plate. The plate is right, but the plate is a bit bent. When the tension comes on the plate, it's going to want to straighten out like that, isn't it? If it does straighten out like that, what's going to happen to these teeth? So they're going to pull out of the strut. So this will let go if it's put in tension. They've got to be straight. If it's bent like that, there's a problem. Again, is it a catastrophe? No, we can put a strap, feed the strap underneath the top plate on top of the beam. They can be forced through that kind of a gap and then nail it off and you can fix up that kind of connection. So it is possible to do repair work on the run while the roof structure is being built. Now, tying down the roof structure to masonry walls, AS4773 says we've got straps in the wall. The straps are installed by the bricklayer, and then they're tied off into the roof by a different trade by the carpenter. So we hope the bricklayer's got them all in the right place, and we hope the carpenter is able to put them into the right place in the roof structure. We do require straps all of the way around the perimeter. If we're tying down the walls, all of the roof all of the way around the perimeter, we've got to have the straps there to do it. And it doesn't matter what direction the wind is blowing from, it's going to cause uplift on the roof in all directions, so we need it around the entire perimeter. That includes the garage. So that the garage also has to have straps that are going to enable us to tie the roof down into the structure. There are three ways in which this can be done. This, in each of these diagrams, the left-hand diagram shows a roof with eaves and one without eaves. You can tie your straps down directly to rafters so that the rafter is transferring load directly into the strap, which is picking up the weight of some brickwork underneath. If you do that, the strap's got to be vertical and tight, looped over the rafter. So looped over the rafter and fastened with at least four nails after the looping. Right, so you put it over the top, that looping is going to give it quite a bit of strength, and then four nails on the other side. Here's a strap. Can you see some problems with that? Is it vertical? Is it tight? And it's snaking over the top of the metal batten. So it's not going to be able to do its job. The other way is to put the tie down strap over the top plate. If we put it over the top plate, we've tied the top plate down, but now we've got to transfer the load from the rafter into the top plate. So we need triple grips on every single top rafter to transfer those uplift loads into the top plate so we can then tie it down under the brickwork. And that works for either of those two cases as well. Again, they've got to be vertical and tight. That one's not too bad. It's got to be nailed off on the top or the back with at least four nails. And we need a triple grip. All right, so the triple grip is missing. Just have a look at that bird's mouth. Is that a complying bird's mouth? No, it's a pretty savage bird's mouth. I wouldn't want to be standing on this edge of that particular rafter. Straps from masonry walls over overbattens. So here we have an overbatten, and the overbatten has to sit immediately above the wall cavity, in order for this to work. If it's not, the strap's not going to be vertical. If we want our strap to be vertical and tight, it's that overbatten has to sit right over the top of the wall. In the case of a wall without eaves, it's really easy to do. It's the outside batten. If we do this, everything is hunky-dory. If we do that, once we get tension onto that batten, what's it doing to the brickwork here? It's pushing outwards on the brickwork. So pushing outwards on the brickwork is going to cause some damage to the house. It's also going to allow that strap to lengthen a little bit, and that will allow air in under the roof so that it's not going to do its job. This is a catastrophe. They've put them over the top of some metal battens. Again, we shouldn't be seeing that. So what we've looked at is principles. The principles of tying a house all of the way from the roof down through the roof structure into the wall structure. What are some common construction issues? And we're going to work our way through each of these common construction issues, because these are things we have seen in houses that have been damaged in high wind events, and these are things that the Building Commission have picked up in their audits on tying down of roofs. Re-roofing. If you've got a tiled roof, it's heavy, so that we have to tie each tile down, but the weight of the whole roof means we don't have to do much tying down to the walls. If we replace a heavy tiled roof with a lightweight steel roof, we've not got all of that weight, and we now have to extend the tie down into the walls. In the front of the house, they had done that. They'd actually put some extra tie downs, but they weren't effective. The tie downs weren't enough. You can see it's lifted a couple of rows of bricks there, and the couple of rows of bricks have not been enough to keep the top of the roof on. So if we're replacing a tile roof with a sheet roof, all of the tie down chain has to be strengthened right of the way down through the house. It's not a cosmetic thing. It's a structural thing that we're doing, and it requires structural solutions. Battens, we're seeing a large number of 45 millimeter battens. AS 1684 gives us details for 35 millimeter battens. If we look at a screw through a 35 millimeter batten, that's the embedment into the rafter. If we look at it into a 45 millimeter batten, that's the embedment. So the capacity in here is that capacity, not this capacity. It'll be weaker through a 45 millimeter batten. This is a 75 millimeter screw. If we wanted the same embedment in a 45 millimeter batten, we'd have to use a screw that was 85 millimeters long. Right, you can't get them, so we're recommending that you use 100 millimeter screws in 45 millimeter battens. That way you don't have to think. Problems with straps. Not enough nails, loose or bent. This one here, they've got a nail there and some more nails up here that you can't see. What's going to happen to that nail when the tension gets put on the ping onto the underside of the roof? Okay, as it gets shot out. Okay, triple grips and framing anchors, that's how to do it. good nails properly driven through the holes by hand. But you can use gun nails, and we'll explore that. Is that right? No. With this guy here, again, if we put tension on it, it's going to tend to straighten like that, and it's going to do what to the nails? Just jack the nails out of both members, right? So the triple grips should be installed this way so that the fold is vertical. If it's installed like that, again, these nails aren't fully embedded into the member. They're going to bend, and we're going to lose capacity out of that connection as well. So they should be vertical, the fold line should be vertical, and it should be hard up against both members. Nailing problems. We could write an essay on nailing problems. This one here obviously hasn't got enough nails. Should have four, and it's only got two in each leg. This one here's got its four. Isn't that great? Now, they're gun-driven nails, machine gun-driven nails, I'd say, they probably is going to hold. But what's it done to the metal? It's created a line of perforation through the metal. So in the building industry, we've got to look at this and say that is not what the manufacturer recommends. They recommend something different. Don't do it that way. It's probably not going to be enough to condemn that roof, but certainly in some cases, we're starting to see these failing through lines of weakness that are put into the to the triple grips in tests that have been done at James Cook University. So these nails here have actually missed it. That nail has missed it. This nail has missed it. That nail has missed it. So they're not able to do too much at all. The nailing companies say you can use a gun-driven nail, but only if the nails are not too close together, near the edge, and the gun-driven nails are not too close to the holes in the plate. Overdriving. So here's a plywood sheet that's got nails overdriven in it. What's that going to do to the plywood sheet? It's virtually punched through the plywood sheet, so they're not going to do their job. Here it's punched through a strap, so it's not going to do its job. These ones are underdriven, so they haven't got the right amount of embedment. Unfortunately, 1684 doesn't say anything about over and underdriving nails. But it is important that we do follow manufacturers' recommendations and drive nails properly so that these things aren't a problem. This nail here has been too close to the edge of both the strap, and it's cut the strap at the edge, but it's also too close to the edge of the timber and blowing that off, so that nail is not too effective. Another nailing problem, this is a stainless steel strap, and here we've got mild steel nails in it. Even before construction is finished, these have started to rust. Okay, so that galvanic action is going to happen if you mix your metals. So stainless steel strap, you should be using stainless steel nails. If not, they're going to corrode and lose strength. Okay, and these nails are clouts, so that they've got effectively a welded head. They're not going to be able to do the same job as a connector nail is. Okay, tie down of big things. So here is a steel beam. Here is a tie down rod that's been installed. They've missed. They haven't lined up. And they've used some ingenuity here to get the load into the beam. Isn't that what Australia's all about? Ingenuity. Problem, we'll fix it. What's going to happen if this beam starts to have some uplift on it? We're now going to rotate that beam, pull it off its mountings, and it's going to crash down sideways onto the roof. We've got to have our rods close to the steel beam and anchored properly into the steel beam, a bit like that. So these are alfrescos. So these are alfresco beams here. There's a rod bolted to each of those beams, tied down to some brickwork. And notice that the rafters are tied down to each rafter is tied down to the beam. We've got a continuous load path down through here. What we were seeing for quite a while is that end was tied down, but the other end wasn't. It just sat into the brickwork. But here you can see they have tied it into the brickwork and there as well. This one is missing the triple grips. We do need to tie each of the rafters down to those beams. And that works for our frescoes, garage beams, also porticos that we're seeing out the front of buildings. Hip and valley rafters are bigger than a normal rafter. Why? They've got a longer span and they pick up more load. So if we look at the tributary area of a hip rafter, the tributary area of a valley rafter, and a tributary area of a standard rafter, that's where the load is coming from into those particular elements. And we tie these guys down properly. Do we tie down the hip rafters? Because the hip rafters actually attract more load. They should have a bigger tie down than the standard rafters. Often, we don't see any tie downs on the hip rafters. Okay, girder trusses. So girder trusses, we've met before, they pick up a lot of extra load through all of these truss boots, and they have to be tied down to the wall properly. These jack trusses are all tied down with a little strap, and the same little strap has been used to tie down the girder truss. Is that going to work? No, the girder truss is going to fly. So girder trusses do require extra tie downs. We're seeing more non-coupled roofs. So things like skillion roofs and these cathedral ceiling type roofs here, you can't get any triangulation into it. So every element has to be tied down. Battens tied down properly to the rafters, and then the rafters are tied into this roof beam with these joist hangers. And that's going to work quite happily. At this end, the beam has to have a really big connection to this beam across this way, and then that beam has to be tied down at each end. And that was done not too badly. My problem was with what happened at this beam here. Look at where the load has gone into it. We've got 16 big joist hangers putting load into it and a pair of skew nails to the top of the stud. All right, is that going to be able to transfer the load down to the ground? No, it isn't. So for non-coupled roofs, we've got to ensure that each end of every beam is tied down into the ground. Tie downs around large openings. That is a massive opening, isn't it? A huge opening. We've got 15 rafters coming down onto that. So 15 rafters into the lintels that are running across here. So we've got a huge amount of force at each end of the lintels. What do we use to tie that down? A strap, the same strap, 900 millimetres down into the brickwork. That's what was on this particular job. Let's think a bit about what happens around a large opening. We get lots of uplift force that has to go down into the brickwork, and if we're using masonry straps at 900, we're going to pick up that amount of brickwork. What do you notice about that brickwork? Half of it's gone, right? The window itself, or the opening itself, means we don't have this weight of brickwork anymore. So even to get the same weight of brickwork, we've got to anchor this further down into the structure. And then we want to pick up a bit of extra weight to counter the uplift forces into the lintel. So we would want to have a strap that goes all of the way down into the brickwork like that. What happens if you've got two large openings close together? Now that's the weight of brickwork that we can pick up for those two large openings. Is that going to work? We're going to have to tie not to the bottom of the wall, but where? Right into the slab, so that we're picking up the weight of the slab for that type of situation. Here's a tie-down checklist. And as we look at this tie-down checklist, we notice that it's working from the bottom up. That's because that's the way we build houses. So we're thinking about tie-down when we're looking at connections to slabs and footings around large openings. So that as the slab is being poured, we have to think, where do we want the tie downs into the slab around our large openings? And that includes things like alfresco beams, garage beams, big openings in family rooms. So that the tie downs up through the walls. As we're building the walls, we're building the tie downs for the roof into those walls. And when we get to the top of the walls, we've got to now look at connecting them into the roof structure, tie down through the roof structure, up through the battens, and then finally the cladding is screwed on. So we build our tie down chain from the bottom up, but we have to be thinking about it as we're pouring the slab. If we're doing framed walls, we don't have the weight of all of that brickwork, and so we have to follow again from the bottom, the bottom plate to the slab, and then up through all of the walls. Once we get to the top plate level, it's exactly the same tie down frame system above that. But we do have to be thinking about our tie down as we're going from the bottom of the building all of the way to the top. Okay, garage doors. I'm going to spend just a few slides looking at openings. And these are some openings that are pretty important to us. If this opening fails in a strong wind event, it allows a lot of air into the building. That doubles the forces on the roof, and you can see the roof has started to fail here. That's not smart engineering. It costs a few thousand dollars to replace a garage door. It costs tens of thousand dollars to replace the whole roof. If a garage door fails, we would think, yeah, a couple of thousand dollars to replace the garage door. We would not think it's sensible to have to replace a whole roof because a garage door has failed. Windows and doors. So that these windows here have failed because the frame itself was non-complying. So that the frame was non-complying and it allowed the sashes to be pushed into the building at a load about half its design load. So we know they had to be non-complying. Be on the lookout for non-complying windows, and the Australian Windows Association have got a really good web page on that. Now, corner windows. I said that the edge of roof and the edge of walls have much higher forces on them. So if we've got a window near the corner, it's going to have much higher forces on it than a window in the middle of the wall here. So that even an N1 window, we've got to differentiate between the corner windows and windows away from a corner. What's a corner window? If any panel of the window has more than 25% of it within 1200 millimetres of the corner, then that is going to be a corner window. So here we've got two corner window panels and the rest are general. And the corner ones are going to be built and tested to higher wind pressures. Even if we get the right window, if it's not fixed properly into the frame, then we're going to have a problem. When the wind is blowing on this window here, you can see it's putting all of those nails into bending. Now, there are lots of nails, but they're just going to bend, aren't they, and let the window blow into the building. If we were to just put packers on the and drive the nails through those packers, then we're going to get much better window performance. And again, Australian Window Association's got some great videos, including how to install into double brick construction. Finally, wind-driven rain. So that this is all about the way that buildings can prove to be not fit for purpose, not perform properly. Water can enter through windows and doors, flashings, valleys and box gutters, and I'm going to focus particularly on flashings. This flashing here was fastened by pop rivets. Now, if you pick up a piece of flashing, it's floppy, right? So you pick it up, it flops around all over the place. It's saying that it's weak. If we pick up a piece of roofing, it's fairly stiff. You can pick it up in the middle and it'll flop a little bit, but it won't fold. Okay, so that we fasten roofing down, stiff roofing down with these big screws, and we fasten floppy flashing down with pop rivets. Does that sound sensible? We should be using the same sort of connections, the same screws, and putting it into every exposed surface. Here it was hard to put any fastenings into there, so they didn't. And as a result of that, the wind found it. Once you get the flashing lifting, what happens? Water drives in, and that's what a ceiling looks like after the water has been driven in. Valley gutters. I've had water through my valley gutters. Put your hands up if you've had water through your valley gutters. Yep. Probably half the people in the room. And it's because when the wind is behind the water, it drives the water up the valley gutter. When it gets to here, what happens? Over the top and you get a waterfall. All right. So that valley gutters do let water in. They don't have to. It is possible to do something about it by putting a little foam compression strip in the top. And I'm building a new house this year and my house is going to have these all through. Everywhere there's a valley gutter. Okay, those are common construction issues everywhere. The cyclonic areas have a few extras that they've got to deal with. So cyclonic areas, we're looking at cyclone washers, we're looking at, in Western Australia, mainly metal construction. The cyclone region extends from Shark Bay right of the way to the Northern Territory border. with this area here between Carnarvon and Port Hedland, wind region D. So that's what we're talking about. Now, as we look at this roof here, you say, that's got to be pretty good. Lots of cyclone washes. They seem to be quite close together, but they're the wrong cyclone washes. Now, the roof manufacturers have tested their, they have to test their cyclonic roofing to the low, high, low cyclic testing regime. They do that with cyclone washers that take the load away from the area that the fastener goes through and put it further afield. These are trim deck cyclone washers made for a square topped roofing, and it's got corrugated. So they're not going to do the job. And the owner is going to be really disappointed when their really good looking roof system fails because of metal fatigue and because the wrong washers have been used. Here's a roof where inexplicably a couple of fasteners have been missed out. This one here doesn't look too bad, and in fact when I showed it to a colleague he said, wow, that looks pretty good. But have a look at the overhang on the edge of the sheet. Much more than the roofing manufacturer recommends. And this is the top area of a fairly steep roof. There's really high uplift in that region, and their batten spacing is just too wide up there. Overhang on the edge as well, a bit of a problem. Okay, internal pressure. In the cyclone areas, AS4055 designs for full internal pressure, so that the tie downs you get from AS4055 should have full internal pressure. These are houses from cyclones. This one here, a door blew in. So it wasn't as even as though a window broke or some debris happened. The latch failed on the door and the door blew in. And you can see the huge amount of damage that was done to it with that full internal pressure. If we don't design for full internal pressure, this is what can happen if a door latch fails. This one here was a window failing that meant that door went. Metal frame, and I've mentioned this already, it's really important that we use the right thickness of material, because we get really high stress concentrations in thin pieces of metal, they're going to tear. And that's what happened here. Those actually pulled over the top of the batten screws which were left in the trusses. And these were the trusses that were just about to let go, and some of them had already in that particular event. Wind classification for doors, get it right. Identify whether your door or window is a corner door or window. If it is, it's going to have higher pressures on it, and it should be a stronger window. Even though it might be designated a C1 window, it will be a C1 corner window, and it will have been designed for higher pressures. It is possible to get it right. These were two windows that failed in a recent Western Australian cyclone, and there is a neighbouring house that didn't even cop a lot of water into it. So it is possible to get windows right. Now, flashings, we've mentioned flashings. It doesn't take much to start driving water up surfaces of buildings. In cyclone areas, it's going to be at about 25% of the design wind velocity. So even little tropical cyclones that don't do a lot of structural damage can do water damage. And if you're going to fasten your flashings down, don't do it to the cladding, do it to the frame underneath, because if it lets go out of the cladding, then you lose your flashing anyway. So in summary, we've covered lots of territory today. We've looked at the performance of houses as being really important, and it is. To you as a homeowner, the house that you shelter in when a storm is happening is looking after your life. We in the building industry have to be aware of the fact that we are building protection for a family every time we put in a connection as part of a tie-down system. It is really important to get it right. Connections are the key to good performance. Ensure that we've got a good chain of strength and that the connections look right. Have an idea of how much area that connection is getting load from and say, does this connection actually look right for a connection that's going to be pulling load from a 4 square meter area of roof? Aim for triangulation in the roof structure. Don't skimp on it. Look for opportunities to build triangulation in, and particularly make sure that all of your batten to truss, or batten to rafter connections are okay. That's a problem in every single wind area in Western Australia. Resources, there are lots of good resources around. These ones here are targeted specifically for builders and look at wind classification and re-roofing. There are lots of other resources as well. This has recently been published by Wood Solutions. It's a free download on building timber houses to resist winds. There's lots of information from manufacturers, and the Building Commission has got information pages on their website as well. So there is lots of really great information out there that can help you.